In 1972, a young actor, or more properly, a young exhibitionist, who calls himself Harry Reems, spent a day in a studio in Miami performing varied sexual acts before a moving picture camera and accepted a check for $100, which is less than he'd have got as a gigolo working the same shift. But it turned out that the movie he helped make was Deep Throat, one of the all-time big money winners in the hard porn circuit. The feds decided this time to move and invoked the law against commerce and obscenity. They nabbed him in Memphis, prosecuted him, and he was found guilty. As could have been predicted, his case has been transmuted into a free speech case, and he's got professors from here and there saying if Harry Reems goes to jail, so will the author of The Song of Solomon or anybody else who writes about smog in Los Angeles. The lead lawyer in the case is Mr. Alan Dershowitz, professor of law at Harvard, graduate of the Yale Law School of Brooklyn College, former clerk to Supreme Court Justice Arthur Goldberg, consultant to various national commissions on mental health, civil disorders, violence, marijuana, drug abuse, legal theoretician for Patty Hearst, author of Criminal Law Theory and Process. Mr. Reems has been doing the lecture circuit to raise money to pay his legal bills and making the case for the First Amendment, rather like Fannie Hill, arguing in favor of the Interstate Commerce Clause. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Dershowitz whether he has pitched to the porno tycoons for the legal expenses.
No. First of all, the legal expenses are very much a part of the whole problem in the case. The strategy of the government often is to, knowing that they're going to lose the battle, hope to win the war by financially bankrupting those who would make films of this kind or of others in the same genre. The attempt, and it's been used widely in, for example, the prosecution against Hair, the musical, the people who bring the prosecutions know that they're going to lose the case, but by hoping to bankrupt the enterprise before it can get off the ground, they think they're going to win the war that way. So it's a very important issue to make sure that somebody like Mr. Reems has enough money to at least pay his legal expenses, putting aside fees, just the expenses, which mount up to the tens of thousands of dollars. The tycoons, of course, have nothing to do with this case. The uniqueness of this case is that it's a prosecution against Mr. Reems,
no,
an actor.
But they have a tremendous interest in his winning the case.
I'm not sure.
Why not?
I'm not sure.
Some of the basic arithmetic I saw on the subject was that there are about 15 million people who spend about $30 a piece on hardcore. That makes $450 million. We know how much money Deep Throat has made. So why wouldn't the producers who made that much money back extensively all legal maneuvers to make it possible for them to have a sequel?
Well, first of all, winning the case for Harry Reems will not necessarily make it easier for producers of pornography to disseminate their material.
Well, how many defendants are there?
There are 16 or so, but I'm representing only Mr. Reems. The issue in this case for me is the very important issue of the scope of the conspiracy law in this country. That is, whether Mr. Reems, who for one day's work in 1972, making a film which he completed, had nothing to do with transporting it in interstate commerce, can get hooked up in the web of conspiracy law as a conspirator to events that he had no part in, with people who he never met, in an act, that is, transporting a film in interstate commerce, which he had no interest in.
Well, we can get to that in due course. It seems to me extremely unlikely that anybody who did what he did during that day in 1972 found that somehow the whole product was inconsistent with his spiritual intentions during his appearance. I understand what you're saying about the conspiracy law, that it's a tricky law, but what I don't understand is really why there should be any shortage of funds, because if the court succeeded in respect of Mr. Reems, what would result is people refusing to unfrock for pornographers. Now, that would be terrible, wouldn't it? And then, you know, how would they make a pornography? Or, as a matter of fact, there are 400 movies featuring beasts, I understand. Would they be reduced to those?
No, I think, of course, you make a point that everybody in the entertainment industry has an interest in free expression and has an interest in seeing that the government doesn't try to serve as A, super censor, but B, even more importantly, trying to throw actors in jail for acts which were perfectly lawful at the time they were done, which indeed are lawful in many parts of the country today. After all, Deep Throat is showing in many, many parts of the country. In your introduction, you mentioned that Mr. Reems was picked up in Memphis.
Exactly.
That's an ironic and interesting mistake. Mr. Reems was never in Memphis. Neither did Deep Throat show in
Memphis. Well,
I meant
picked up legally. He was prosecuted in Memphis.
I know, but it's a legal fiction.
Well, Deep Throat was also found obscene in New York City.
Well, but it was found not obscene in many parts of the country. And the point is, can Mr. Reems participate in the making of a film which can legally be shown in many parts of the country? Put another way, what is the federal interest? Why does the federal government have an interest in preventing the shipping of a film in interstate commerce when many of the places to which it will be and can be shipped have not stated any interest in prohibiting the film from showing there? It seems to me to be a federal intrusion that I think
The Constitution may have made a mistake in giving to the federal government sovereignty over interstate commerce, but in fact it did.
Well,
and it decided that one of the things that shouldn't have the advantages of interstate commerce is pornography. That's an interesting question, but I don't see that it's usurpatory.
Well, the Constitution, of course, never said that. It only gave Congress the power to take authority over some materials in interstate commerce. The Constitution doesn't mention pornography either in the First Amendment or in the Commerce Clause. Plainly, even if the Constitution gave Congress the power to do this, Congress acts very unwisely when it takes this power. There are many, many more important things for Congress to do.
Well, Congress acts very unwisely most of the time.
Well, this is just one example.
On the other hand, it seems to me that for it to exercise, as it has traditionally, the right to discourage, for instance, the use of the post office for transporting obscene materials, it's okay by me. It's essentially a moral question, isn't it? It's not so much a legal question.
Oh, it's not a moral question at all. It only becomes a moral question if I am doing something in your presence that offends you, and then we have to decide a moral question, basically who's right. But if I'm doing something in the privacy of the privacy of first-class mail that offends you, just don't open my mail and you won't be offended.
I don't think it's that simple. If it were that simple, there would be no laws against your consuming heroin in whatever quantities pleased you.
No, there would be laws against that, because there is some evidence correlating the use of heroin with violent crime. There are very indirect relationships, but I see the government.
There is some evidence correlating certain kinds of pornography and violent crime. Read the Moore's murders.
Yeah, I think that evidence is not, even the Supreme Court recently in sustaining pornography laws discounted that kind of evidence, and they, with you, agreed it was a moral issue. That is, that obscenity is a sin, not a crime, and in a secular society.
Well, of course, some sins are crimes, too, you know. Fortunately, there's a congruity between divine and social and legal sanctions in many areas.
We have a firm basis for law.
Sure, murder would be an example. But before we get seduced into sort of a general argument on pornography, which I think is inevitable, let's take some of the arguments along the line. For instance, the conspiracy count. Is it your position that all conspiracy laws are invalid? Do you go along with the learned hand sort of general suspicion about conspiracy counts, or do you simply think it's invalid in cases like this one? And if so, why?
Well, I go along with the general suspicion expressed by Learned Hand and Justice Jackson and many others about the overuse of conspiracy. On the other hand, I've done a little historical research on conspiracy, and my own view is that it is unthinkable for a society not to have some conspiracy law. It is often said Europe doesn't have a conspiracy law. Of course they do. They call it group crime. When many people get together to commit a serious act, the government has an interest in prohibiting that kind of joint conduct. The real question is how to use conspiracy in a sensible and not in a promiscuous way. And it seems to me that to use the conspiracy law to tell Mr. Reems that he has conspired with people who he never met to do an act which occurred 2 years after he finished doing his act, in an area which is as sensitive as this one, because after all, we are talking about, although this case involves a film which, although I haven't seen, I'm told, is a piece of junk, the conspiracy to commit obscenity laws have also been used in cases involving fairly serious films, carnal knowledge, films and books which a generation of Americans found to be offensive, and a later generation of Americans came to cherish. So when you combine the objective qualities of an overbroad use of conspiracy law with the sensitive areas of the First Amendment, I think you really have a very important problem, and that's why I'm in the case.
Well, wait a minute. You don't have to know the people with whom you conspire in order for it to be an effective conspiracy, right?
No. No. You can have a conspiracy without having met the people. No, not so much for that one, but that's an important issue. That is, any one of these elements alone doesn't take you out of a conspiracy, but when you bring them all together, it's very important. The fact that you haven't met your conspirators tells you something about the nature of the kind of conspiracy charge that's being brought.
Well, let's ask Mr. Reems, did you know that there were anti-obscenity laws?
At the time when I acted in Deep Throat, which was back in 72, the law that was in existence related to obscenity gave me a clear indication, as did my attorneys, that I was working within the sanction of the law.
Did you consult an attorney?
At the time I had talked, well, Deep Throat was not the first film of that genre that I performed in. Mm-hmm. And in talking with attorneys prior to working in those films, I was told that I was protected by the law as it was written at the time.
And what was the redeeming social importance of
well,
Deep Throat?
I think the law as it stated at the time said for something to be found obscene, it must be utterly without social redeeming value. And I think you can take practically anything, a cigarette butt, and find social redeeming value in it, and that someone manufactured
well,
and made a living from
it. The Supreme
it.
Court can, maybe, but I can't. Explain to me the redeeming social value in the cigarette
just
butt.
Just take one aspect of it. Just take the political aspect of it. Deep Throat created controversy when it first came out.
So did the assassination of Martin Luther King. Does that have redeeming social value?
Well, I don't think you can take that as an analogy. Well, I think we're talking about an entity here that raised the conscience, raised the question throughout society, well, what is obscenity?
I think that the murder of Martin Luther King raised the consciousness of racial discrimination as it had never been raised before.
Okay, but we're not talking, murder is not protected. If murder has social redeeming value, it is not protected.
No, but
it's still
illegal. You're using arguments by analogy, so why can't I use arguments by analysis? No. Did I say cigarette butt first?
No, all right, fine. Excuse me.
And therefore, the analogy was yours. Okay. Now, I'm asking what, because you and Mr. Dershowitz seem to take it for granted that under Roth, Deep Throat was unprosecutable. And I don't see that at all.
Well, let me state my legal argument. I'm not taking that for granted. A jury should have determined that. Mm-hmm. And what we're asking for is a remand for a new trial, or an acquittal, of course, but at the very least a remand for a new trial under which a jury, not you, not me, not Mr. Reems, would determine under the proper standard, under the Roth standard, whether Deep Throat is utterly without socially redeeming value. Let me state two or three possible socially redeeming values that we would introduce
even without seeing it
at the trial, even without seeing it. And one of them is the fact that, for example, Time magazine a couple of weeks ago indicated that in the Gomar Explorer, which rescued one of our most important possessions, a Soviet nuclear sub, the sailors on that ship regarded as the most popular film that they saw every day, supplied by the United States Navy, none other than Mr. Reems, in Deep Throat.
Does that give it redeeming social value?
Sure. That is, there are people, you and I may not agree, but there are people who are isolated from their families on a boat who like to see a film like Deep Throat. Why do we have to second guess that?
People I see on a boat who would like a shot of heroin, too.
Well, if no harm resulted from that, and if they were mature enough to make
it.
But we know that harm doesn't result. If the United States Navy thought that harm would result from sailors watching Deep Throat, then they surely acted irresponsibly, let me add one word, perhaps conspiratorially. Mm-hmm. Why was the United States Navy not involved in this conspiracy?
Would you take the position that if the United States Navy came out for the nuclearization of Hanoi, there should be no questioning its wisdom?
No, I think you question the wisdom, but what you do is that the United States government at least sets a minimum standard of acceptability, not a maximum, but when the United States government says something is acceptable, then it's hard for another branch of the government to say it's utterly without socially redeeming
value. I don't think
it's
hard at all, because the acts differ in provenance. If somebody says, you know, while you're in Paris, bring me back a filthy picture, mm-hmm. even the person who does that is a federal marshal, it hardly suggests that the filthy picture has redeeming social value.
No,
in virtue of his having supplied you, does it?
No, but if a branch of the United States government in its official capacity does that, at least it's a relevant argument. Other reasons of socially redeeming value. I am told there are people who literally never saw acts of sexual intercourse performed before and were very ignorant about its nature, about its techniques, about methods of doing it. I think that bringing pornography with some degree of taste to the screen performs an important social value. It may be distasteful. We may not like it, but there are people who like it. Several million people have seen it. Cassettes have been made of Deep Throat that many... Let me make it clear, I'm not making a brief Deep Throat.
A lot of brothers who never thought of incest until they saw some of these films, and all of a sudden now they think of incest as the most highly available kind of sex. Is that something we want to encourage?
No, we've made a judgment, and a judgment that I think is...
Not a lot of people who are falling over themselves in despair over Harry Eames' case. You won't find any denunciations of incest.
But incest, almost by definition, involves non-consenting or very young people. It doesn't involve consensual.
Not by any means at all.
Not by definition, but I think the vast majority of cases of incest involve one party under the age of 21 in a familial relationship with an adult.
The vast number of licentious sex involves people under the age of 21.
No, I don't think the vast majority of people, for example, who watch a film like Deep Throat are under the age of 21 or under the age of 18. In fact, it's had its appeal primarily to older people who have felt a need for one reason or another to see the film. And I, for one, don't think I'm prepared to second-guess that need.
Let me put it this way, because obviously the statistics bend in your favor, since there are many more people over 21 than there are under 21. But let's say that between the ages of... between the ages of, say, 15 and 21, there are probably more people who have seen Deep Throat than between the ages spanning any six-year interval from there on out. You probably can see that, wouldn't you?
Well, I'm prepared, of course, also...
The curiosity factor.
It could be. I'm prepared to concede the state the right to regulate films like Deep Throat as it relates to young people, despite our audience here who might object to that. I think also I'm prepared, by the way, I'm a vigorous opponent of exploitation of porno films on marquees of theaters. I'm a vigorous opponent, for example, of nudists who parade around in front of people who are object to nudity. I only defend the right of these kinds of films to play in discreet locations, in discreetly marked theaters, in a way so that nobody's morality is violated. The analogy I make is to the birth control clinic in Connecticut. When the first birth control clinics opened in Connecticut in Catholic neighborhoods, people were very offended in those neighborhoods because they knew what was going on inside, behind the closed doors of that clinic. And the Supreme Court said...
It was, by the way, a Congregationalist lobby that imposed those laws.
Oh, I'm not, for a moment, limiting it to only to Catholic neighborhoods or the Catholic Church. The phenomenon I was describing involved, in fact, Catholic opposition to a birth control clinic. It might have involved Jewish opposition, because there is such opposition among Jewish people as well. In any event, the Supreme Court said to the people, in a heterogeneous society, you just have to learn to tolerate what goes on behind closed doors. And I think the same thing is true whether it's the practice of birth control or whether it's the practice of a pornographic film, which is why I think this is a case that involves more than simply the First Amendment, but also the right of privacy. It's a case that, in fact, in many ways is more of a privacy case than a First Amendment case, because I'm prepared to concede that we could have a very vigorous First Amendment which didn't protect films at all. If we simply passed a law saying from now on films are not covered by the First Amendment, that wouldn't convert us into a totalitarian society automatically, but it's a better society which has a vigorous support of any media and any film, no matter what its content.
Well, I don't think it's necessarily a better society. Surely a society which condones it having the presumed power not to condone the reduction of sex to its exclusive biological dimensions is no more commendable than a society that reduces liquor to its pure alcoholic.
There's the essential fallacy of your view, I think, and that is your view suggests that by allowing something under the First Amendment, the society condones it. My view is that society does not condone something just because it permits it. Now, if you take the view that it condones it by permitting it, then you're going down a slippery slope. Then the society always asks the question, is this something we want to condone and encourage? And I would probably agree we don't want to condone a great many of these things.
That's a legitimate point. I should have said licenses. Mm-hmm. I think that's an important distinction. The whole approach of the Genocide Convention, for instance, whose impulse came after a bloody experience 30 years ago in Germany, assumes that causes have, that words have consequences.
I believe they do.
And certainly anyone who a substantial part of whose vicarious experience in sex is encouraged in the kind of reductionism that the porno market and magazines like Hustler approve of coarsens human sensibilities. And if indeed no freedom is possible, as was predicted by the Federalist Papers, except in a virtuous citizenry, it becomes a legitimate political concern of society to discourage such settlements, whether they are genocidal or whether they are reductionist in respect of the human body.
I don't disagree with you on that. You may be surprised to hear that. I really do believe that words have impact on conduct and that pornography, in fact, may coarsen sensibilities. I think that there are a great many things in our world that coarsen sensibilities and that I would prefer to do without. On the other hand, the real issue between us is whether it is an appropriate tool of society to ban the kind of speech which may, in fact, coarsen conduct. And I would draw a sharp distinction, as I think the Constitution does, between courses of conduct which encourage genocide, which encourage racial hatred, and those which have much more subtle, much less discernible, much more questionable impacts. Mm-hmm. Because to move toward a regime of censorship on the ground of heightening sensitivities, I think the cost simply isn't worth the very, very reasonable values that one might expect in return.
Okay, that's your point of view. Then there is the my point of view. Mm-hmm. Now, how shall we decide which point of view shall prevail except by democratic methods? And as I understand it, the Congress of the United States passed this particular law, intending to discourage people like Mr. Reems. Mm-hmm. Now, the passage of that law was a reflection, presumably, in the model anyway, of the prevalence of my opinion over your own. You are reaching for a deus ex machina that will illegitimize my opinion as somehow incompatible with a generic protection that you pull out of the Constitution, which was never there until you all discovered it quite recently.
No, I don't think it's a deus ex machina at all. The Constitution includes, of course, three branches of government. And what Congress did here was not passing a law making it a crime for Mr. Reems to participate in the making of a film in Florida one day in 1972. It passed a general bill prohibiting the shipping and interstate commerce
of the kind of thing Mr. Reems does.
Material. And it also passed a general conspiracy law. Nobody in Congress ever thought about whether or not it should apply those two laws in tandem to bring about a conviction of this kind. Indeed, you talk about democratic institutions. The democratic institutions of a great many states have now decided that Mr. Reems' film is not bannable, that it does have socially redeeming value. Is it really democratic for the United States Congress to hook on to the fact that the film happened to have been transported in interstate commerce to prevent the people from Iowa from seeing a film which the democratic institutions of Iowa said they are perfectly free to see?
Well, I think you're asking the question of whether the federal government has a right to preempt concern in matters mm-hmm. like this. I think it's an interesting argument, and one in which I'm philosophically tend to side with you. It is a matter of fact that the federal government has preempted concern in all manner of matters. They're about to tell us, for instance, that a state can't have a right to work law. They have told us that states can't have anti-subversion statutes. Mm-hmm. Well, there's a whole string of them, as you know. Mm-hmm. Now, is your concern to redress the balance here, your concern for states' rights, or is it your concern to figure out whatever means you can devise, the effect of which will be not to disturb the continuing proliferation throughout America of movies like Deep Throat?
Oh, certainly it's not the latter. I really do hold no.
I don't. Obviously, you have no personal interest in Deep Throat. You hadn't even seen it.
No.
But you have a deep interest in other people's right, quote unquote, to see it.
I think we have to have a basic bottom line which says that if any group in the community finds that it has a legitimate reason for seeing it, if it's a state that says it, if it's the federal government that says it, in order to ban something, it seems to me at the very least there has to be a total union of view that this is not something that is acceptable.
So have you worked out where this line is drawn? For instance, is it in bestiality featuring, say, a cow and an eight-year-old girl, something like that?
Well, it seems to me I'd rather, instead of focusing on what is being shown inside the movie, I think the appropriate concern of the state is to focus on what's being shown outside the movie. And that is, if people want to see cows, I don't understand why people should want to see cows. I don't understand what value is served by that. But personally, if people want to see cows, that's just as good as people wanting to see Cadillacs. There are a lot of people who get very offended
but
by the kind of leisure and luxury and consumptive consumer patterns in this country. I get offended by that too, but I'm not prepared to do anything about it. It seems to me that tastes, we have to accept the fact that you and I are easily offended by the kinds of tastes that run rampant in this country.
I see. As I understand it then, you are taking the position that no movie whatsoever would you stand in the way of anybody wanting to see if it is not advertised in the marquee.
I can't right now think of any movie or any movie that I would be in favor of banning on obscenity grounds.
Including sadism. How about a snuff movie?
Well, you mean a movie in which somebody is actually killed?
Yeah, featuring, say, Gilmore.
I would surely be opposed to the making of that movie in the first place because I place such a high value on human life that I would never...
I suppose you have a perfectly willing guy, victim.
Well, that's hard to conceive of. I mean, I can understand, and it's a very, the Gilmore case is a very complicated one.
But it's not terribly hard to understand. They did it by the tens of thousands in Mexico as recently as 500 years ago.
People willingly submitting to death for purposes
of getting
a fee to make a movie?
No, not they weren't in movies, but simply to propitiate whoever they wanted to propitiate at that particular moment.
Yeah.
The god with all those syllables in his name.
Well, I guess my point of view is this. If something is going on in society, I don't oppose the filming and the showing of it. So that although I'm not one who would like to see executions on television, if there are executions going on in this society, I would not ban a film which showed an execution. That's right.
But, Mr. Dershowitz, the fact of the matter is that things go on as a result of the availability of the cameras. Mr. Reems would not have spent, presumably, that particular day that particular way in Miami, except for the existence of cameras. Mm-hmm. And I'm therefore asking you to meditate on a situation in which somebody is prepared to die or to be killed in order to accumulate money for his estate under the circumstances. Now, this would not happen but for the propulsive factor of the movie cameras. Mm-hmm. Would you stand in the way of it? Because otherwise, I'm terribly afraid that your statement of certain things, if a society is absolutely convinced that there is no question this oughtn't to happen, unless that stage arrives, you oppose. But you can't imagine when that state would arise.
Well, I think I would oppose the making of a film which involved the taking of a human life.
No matter how willing that
person
was.
No matter how willing. I think there are certain limits to commercial taking of
life. What about one that involved the laceration or mutilation of somebody?
Yeah, I think if somebody is really being hurt, if there's a potential for exploitation in the film, I would oppose a film involving a violent rape scene because we know in our society that although people might submit for money to being lacerated or raped or killed, our economic situation in this country is such that perhaps full free choice is not really available. That issue doesn't arise. Mr. Reems was perfectly willing to participate in his film, as was Linda Lovelace. They engaged in harmful to some, but harmless to them, and harmless to the people who see the film, behavior which is legal in most parts of the country, and it was filmed, and people enjoyed watching it. And for me, that's really an end of the matter, although I concede with you that one could find a point at which the conduct is so revolting that we would not want to encourage an economic exploitation of that kind of conduct.
Well, you haven't done much research into this, have you? Because you haven't seen any of these films.
No,
therefore, you don't know whether it will be revolting to that extent, do you?
No, I think I don't have to see it to know the genre of conduct that would be revolting. I would take the position that if there are such things as snuff films, films in which people are killed, I'm prepared to vigorously oppose the making and dissemination of those kinds of films.
And would you say further that any psychologist who came to you and said he knows Linda Lovelace, and he knows that her exposure to this kind of life is causing her perhaps ineradicable damage. Mm-hmm. Would you say that he was eo ipso, in virtue of having made that statement, disqualified?
No, I think you raise a very serious problem. I think there is a problem of exploitation in our society in the area of sex. I, for one, although I champion the right of privacy, do not champion a laissez-faire attitude, for example, in the area of prostitution, because I think prostitutes today are often very much exploited in our society, and I'd like to see protective legislation. Licensing is probably the best word that you use, not laissez-faire, licensing. And I think we do have a responsibility to make sure that people are not exploited in the area of sexual movies, as in the area of other movies, as in the area of other entertainment and other enterprises. We do have an obligation to people to make sure that what appears to be a voluntary consent may not be a product of a society in which their choices are severely constrained.
We have to pause for just a second. Or, Mr. Reems, do you believe that Mr. Dershowitz's suggestion about licensing might be an appropriate solution? Should you be licensed after, say, submitting to psychological investigation? And if so, what might that psychological investigation find about you that would justify the withholding of that license?
Well, if you're tying me in with, say, the area of prostitution, I think there's a definite distinction in there, whereby prostitution proliferates itself on the street to unwilling customers. In many instances, my participation in these films is not a circumstance that raises the same issues. Mine is, we're dealing with questions of people having the right to go into the theater, their own choice to go into a theater. It's not as though in my situation, I'm thrusting my, if you want to call it, exploitive industry upon an unwilling public. So I don't think that there should be licensing as far as performers within the film industry.
Well, but Mr. Dershowitz has said that the state is, or the community is, legitimately concerned lest there be psychic damage. Psychic damage is distinguished from physical damage. How is it going to establish whether there's psychological damage without investigating?
I think there have been investigations. I think there are demographics, and there's the President's Commission's report on obscenity and pornography, which was commissioned in 1968 under President Johnson, which researched for 2 years at a tremendous cost to the taxpayers the effect of these materials upon society, and reported back after 2 years of study that indeed there is no proof that exposure to pornographic materials, sexual materials, has a harmful effect upon society, and indeed in some cases proves to be educational or therapeutical in many instances, and also recommended that Congress abolish all existing obscenity statutes.
Well, there's no question but that there has been a change during the past 10 years, 15 years of the so-called sexual revolution.
But we're talking about effect upon society.
I know. I'm coming to that. Well, for instance, 3 million abortions last year is certainly an effect of something.
Well, now, can you attribute that to pornography?
I don't know. But I'm not sure that President Johnson's committee could have established the opposite. Certainly we know that the incidence of profligate sex has greatly increased during the past 5, 6, 7 years. Now, it's increased on account of something. We're all biologically the same as we were 20, 30, 40 years ago. Question, does profligate sex have a weakening influence on the institution of the family? Does it breed an end to that sense of shame, which I think Professor Walter Burns so rightly points out is an aspect of Western culture and of free men? Does it, in fact, result in more abortions, in more foundlings, in more desertions of newborn children, in a weakening of ties in general? I don't see that 1968 ruling, or rather 1968 commission, exhausted those questions with anything like the finality that justifies us in dealing with sex as though it was simply an extra cup of tea in the afternoon.
I think their investigations were strictly these materials.
Do you go out and rape somebody after seeing pornographic movies?
No.
The answer seems to be no.
The research said
yes,
no.
The answer seems to be no. But if you see a movie in which there is a systematic denigration of women, does it cause you to slightly alter, in ways perhaps imperceptible to yourself, your understanding of the role of women?
I think that the recent years, the change in society in these questions has proved just the opposite, that in fact women are now becoming more outspoken and demanding their rights, both sexually and as entities within our society.
It's mostly their rights to use four-letter words mixed bars. Surely there is no relationship between seeing porn movies and coming out in favor of equal pay for equal work.
No, but the point you're trying to make is that it's degrading to women and puts them back.
Most porn movies remind most men who see them not that women would make good lawyers and good doctors, but they make good sex.
I think in many cases prove to men that women do have rights within sexual.
It always seemed to me a little bit odd that the women have taken two distinct positions about liberal sex. 10 years ago, they were all saying that Playboy was simply an act of high bondage done for the benefit of the economically elite. Then all of a sudden, they decided they ought to have magazines of their own featuring male. Most of those turned out to be read by homos.
Well, but there's no they. There are women today who still take the view that Playboy and Penthouse are objectionable magazine. There are other women who think that the response to that appropriately is to publish their own magazine. The women's movement is a very divided and very complex movement, as it very much should be.
Yeah, but you don't think of the women's movement as in any sense aimed at limiting the exploitation of sex through pornography, do you?
No. You see, I think the problem is you see the issue somewhat too narrowly. I think that there have been major changes in the last 10 years brought about by a complex of factors. Pornography has contributed in the most minor way. For example, Playboy magazine has probably had more of an influence on the sexual revolution than any hardcore porno films. In order to really effectively control society, to achieve the kind of result you want to achieve, you would have to have a much more broadly based regime of censorship. You would have to have a regime of censorship which would have prevented Lenny Bruce from speaking his speeches.
Lenny Bruce went to jail.
And inappropriately so, many of us now realize.
Well, I'm not so sure it was inappropriate.
You would have to ban Playboy magazine. You would probably have to ban Cosmopolitan magazine. Because Cosmopolitan magazine probably has more of an influence on changing sexual mores in our society than any particular porno film. The point is, focusing on the porno film is too narrow. If you want to achieve the result, then you have to have much more censorship. If you want to have free speech, then you have to include Deep Throat. The thing you can't do, it seems to me, is simply ban pornography and accept to get any real payback on that. You have to do a lot more to get the payback.
I think you're right. You have to sort of revitalize a whole central view of man, which is not easily done by the suppression of anything. But the suppression of certain things is an aspect of one's concern. Just as we suppressed the circulation of racist literature in Germany after the war, I think that was a correct thing to do, because it had become blasphemous in the most realistic sense. Mr. Ralph Kavanagh is from the Yale Law School.
Mr. Buckley, you pointed to a number of possible harmful concrete effects of pornography on society. And I wonder if that mode of analysis suggests that you would or would not agree with the proposition that moral revulsion alone, no matter how widely felt, is not a sufficient ground to justify criminal prosecution of those who are involved in books or movies that society disapproves of. Do you feel that there would have to be concrete effects?
No, it's not. Yeah. Moral revulsion is not alone. You got to have a law.
Well, if
moral revulsion results in the passage of legislation, which is presumably what happened in the instant case, then it seems to me that if you have laws, then the idea is you're not supposed to break them.
Well, but is a law based alone? In this society, we also have a notion that not all laws are per se valid, that some exceed the powers of the legislature due to constitutional guarantees. And I'm asking if a law based solely on moral revulsion would be, you feel, sufficient to justify a criminal prosecution, if it served no other purpose,
Under certain circumstances, it seems to me that certain basic civility is owed by all people who live under the same social roof. I don't think that anyone has the right publicly to mock my religion or I theirs. And under the circumstances, I believe that certain laws against blasphemy are understandable. It's much better when those things are regulated by social sanction. If, let's say, there was a musical downtown on the basis of, based on Buchenwald, it seems to me that the proper way to treat it would be to boycott it effectively. But I would not stand in the way of a civic ordinance that denied someone the right to feel such a musical, this particular moment in history, even as I was on the side of Wagner when he denied to George Lincoln Rockwell the right to lead his stormtroopers on a parade of New York City calling for the extermination of all Jews.
But I doubt that Wagner justified that on the basis of his revulsion regarding the views. I think it was because there was a clear and present danger of major disruptions in downtown New York City. And the one final point
I'd make... Well, the ACLU maintained that there was no such danger, that there were plenty of policemen around. There were about 500 cops to each Nazi, which is a pretty good ratio.
But the one final point is that you've been talking about hardcore and porn as if all of us knew what it was, when we know from the Supreme Court that, quote, they know it when they see it, but they've never been able to define it. And the one problem that I see is you have a broadly based definition here that can expand to cover many kinds of conduct, none of which are foreseeable in advance, and you're having criminal prosecutions based on that. And you're going back to moral feelings to justify it.
Look, there may be the shadow cases, I grant that, but Deep Throat was not one of them. I think that anybody who maintains his redeeming social value in Deep Throat is simply having us on. I grant ambiguity in most situations, none in this one. And that's why I think that in going after this particular picture, the prosecution didn't have that seriously to worry about. Ms. Rohde is from Yale Law School also.
Well, if I might pursue that for a moment, simply because I don't share your assertion that there was no ambiguity at all about whether Deep Throat ought to come under the restrictions of the standards currently defined, but expanding that, I wonder if you weren't a little bit troubled by a system of substantive law which permits officious DAs and inconsistent juries to make retrospective determinations about obscenity based on a standard which the Supreme Court itself has conceded isn't readily susceptible to definition.
Now which decision are you talking about? Miller?
Well, absolutely, yes. That makes the community standard dispositive and virtually unreviewable.
Well, and your objection is to what?
Is that it's a retrospective determination based on a standard which is too vague to provide any notice about the scope of the conduct which
What's
prescribed.
Vague about a jury verdict?
Well, but one doesn't know in advance how 12 particular individuals are going...
So you've got to take a chance.
Well, but that's the real problem under the First Amendment.
Yes.
You have to take a chance. Let me shift to another case that happened here in New York City. A fairly disgusting periodical called Screw Magazine gets published in this city and circulates to 100,000 eager New York buyers. Nobody from Kansas reads it. It's not sold on the newsstands, and there are 8 subscribers in the whole state of Kansas. The federal government, knowing that they could never get a prosecution in New York because New Yorkers would return a ho-hum verdict of not guilty by reason of boredom, they've seen so much more, decided to bring a prosecution against Mr. Goldstein in Wichita, Kansas. And so some postal inspectors sent away for a couple of issues, never even opened them, and prosecuted Goldstein under the standards then prevalent in Kansas City. Now, Mr. Goldstein wasn't even taking a chance. He didn't think that he would be prosecuted in Kansas City for a magazine circulated in New York City. That's what happens when you rely on jury verdicts. Every publisher publishing a controversial magazine certainly could have that magazine banned somewhere in the United States. That means we all publish at our risk and at our peril. And I don't know, I don't generally go around mocking people's religions, but you would pass a law making it a crime to mock people's religions. I would have to, every time I lectured, really worry and prepare and wonder whether anything I said might result in somebody somewhere in the United States regarding what I said as a mocking of the religion.
Well,
it would create a chilling effect on free speech, which I think none of us would really
want. I think a chilling effect is very much to be desired right now, myself. That is to say, I think that free speech, the moment it becomes licentious, becomes less than useful. And I think that that many, many, many people are engaged at this moment in undermining the value of free speech precisely by abusing it. Now, this is very difficult to regulate, not something I would want to do. I simply concede philosophically that it is possible at one and the same time to have a robustly free society and one in which certain categories of offenses are not committed.
But, you know, I don't know if you
and
realize...
And this is a position which is the Frankfurter took in the Bournet case.
I don't know if you realize that there are many people in this country, I meet them more frequently than you do, who would, if they could, ban your type of speech. They regard you as mocking their religion, that is, a religion of liberalism, a religion of social welfare. I, on occasion, find myself defending your right to speak and the right of others who are regarded by many as offensive. I happen to find your speech charming, and I like it, but there are many who say, look, really, why should people like Bill Buckley be able to say those kinds of things
you must move in
welfare.
A remarkable circle.
I think probably the circle you move in would ban this kind of conduct is
remarkable. I have never doubted the basic intolerance of most American liberals.
That's right.
It tends to evolve from a certain arrogance about the rightness of their own positions.
It tends to be more a radical view that I hear expressed, but there are some who would ban it. And I find, of course, that terribly intolerable, but to focus on the mocking of religion as opposed to the mocking of philosophical principles, which are just as important, is a line in a secular society I would not be prepared to draw.
You have a preoccupation with lines, the give them an inch, they'll take a mile kind of business. I have less of that than I used to have, in part because it seems to me that societies, if they're intelligent enough to govern themselves at all, are intelligent enough not to go haywire. Sometimes they go haywire. That's mm-hmm. true. The people who argued against the 16th Amendment said, look, if you pass a law that allows an income tax, before you know it, they'll go up to 10% income tax. Mm-hmm. And people said, no, don't worry about it. Don't be ridiculous. They'll never go as high as 10%. And then a few years later, it was 65% for a while during the First World War.
We live in a world where most countries now ban most free speech. I think Senator-elect Moynihan has been right.
We live in a society
where we constrain free speech so much, it's a diminishing quantity. And for us in this country, who have the most robust free speech in the world, and bar none, those who call us a repressive society don't understand what a repressive society is.
No.
To give up that valuable commodity because we are afraid that maybe it would degrade the quality of life somewhat, which might be a reasonable fear.
But you see, the quality of life has been very greatly degraded, mm-hmm. in my judgment. When a magazine like Playboy can make a huge joke over the agony of the crucifixion, mm-hmm. And when nobody simply bothers to mind, what you are doing is cashing in a reservoir that holds the chips, which in turn holds society together. It is perfectly possible that in a climate of that sort, in the future, people will say, what? Go to war against Hitler merely to prevent the extermination of 6 million Jews? What's 6 million Jews to us? This is the kind of attitude that I find fratricidal, psychologically fratricidal, coarsening, and almost certainly the kind of totalitarianism in an opposition to. You seek to mobilize society in order to permit it to encourage it, in effect, to commit these extremes. This is the difficulty I have with the opposition.
But, you know, you also, on occasion, have mocked institutions which are as important to some small and less powerful segments of our society than the crucifixion is to Christians. It seems to me, in a secular society, you can't have it both ways. I prefer a society in which you can mock things that are important to me, and I can mock things that are important to you, and in which both of us have a sensitivity so as not to do it very often.
Well, but as Professor Vandenhoek pointed out in his recent exchange on this general subject, he does believe that the taboos of a society are legitimately protectable. For instance, as he put it, if he was in India, he would vote in favor of guarding the cows as sacred. If he was in Israel, he would continue to vote in favor of raising pigs for slaughtering. By the same token, here, it seems to me, some of the old anti-blasphemy legislation, which was protected at least socially for a while, is something the disappearance of which sets loose in our society certain centripetal forces which we can't govern, centrifugal forces.
But that's exactly the point. There is a big difference between Indian society and Israeli society and our own. We are a heterogeneous society. We are a society composed of so many diverse strains that the taboos, very few of them, are general taboos of a society. The taboos of Wichita, Kansas don't apply in New York City. The taboos of Queens don't apply in Times Square. And it seems to me that for us to make general views about the taboos and compare them to views held throughout a society doesn't really hit the point.
I think I would say there's a pretty general taboo against, say, anti-Semitism. I don't see anti-Semitism practiced in the circles I move. That's, I suppose, a certain amount of underworld iconoclasm at all levels. Mm-hmm. But I don't think, for instance, any journal published in New York City would survive a month if it started publishing anti-Semitism. Look what happened to the American Mercury. And quite rightly so. Mm-hmm. It disappeared from the face of the earth mm-hmm. the moment it went anti-Semitic. That's what I call an effective taboo. Now, it required 6 million people to get killed to heighten that taboo, to gain that effectiveness. Well, that's a very, very high price to pay, and it ought not to be needed. By the same token, I think there ought to be a general social resistance to any journal, much better than the law, as I began by saying, to any journal that treated as frivolously anti-Christianity.
But you look at the situation today in this country, and it's a very good one. We have no laws against anti-Semitism. I, on occasion, get a copy of a despicable anti-Semitic rag called the Cross and the Sword or something, published by Gerald L.K. Smith's gang of hoodlums. And recently I was listed in there as on their list of prominent
Jews. Social sanction
who have
is sufficient.
Been involved in the Carter campaign. It's a revolting magazine, and yet I'm glad it's not banned by law. I'm glad that I'm protected.
I'm glad as long as it isn't all of a sudden becoming a national movement.
If it's becoming a national movement, as Learned Hand once said, even laws probably won't be able to protect us.
Mr. Seth Lerner is from the University of Pennsylvania. Mr. Lerner?
I'd like to begin or pursue the path that we started a few minutes ago, and that is what does or does not constitute obscenity. So I'd like to ask all three of you, beginning with Mr. Reems, what do you think defines obscenity, and specifically then obscene films?
Well, first of all, my particular views on obscenity do not really relate to sexuality. Sexuality is something that, due to its repression over the generations and generations, has blossomed as something that is morally indecent, and I don't go along with those views. To me, I would think that the existence of, we were talking about earlier, snuff films or films that deal with the non-consenting adults where actual bodily harm might be done, or where the public in general would be exposed to the violent act as a form of entertainment, that to me would be something that would fall in my definition of obscenity. But sexuality definitely, in any form, between consenting adults, is something that should not be deemed obscene.
Mr. Dershowitz?
Well, for me, obscenity is something which is very offensively thrust on unwilling seers. Obscenity really and truly is in the eye of the beholder. And what is obscene to one may be lovely to another. I think Mr. Buckley and I tend to share, personally, our views on what is obscene and what is not. But
you're taking David Hume's position that the falling tree doesn't make any noise unless you let it hear it.
Well, I think the dirty film doesn't make any impact unless it's seen by an unwilling observer. So I would define obscenity by its externalities, by how it imposes itself on others. And at that point, when there is a clash, when some people want to see something and want to express it and others don't, then with Mr. Buckley, I agree the democratic institution should prevail. When you have to make a choice, when the nudist wants to appear on the city beach and the dressed people don't want to see him, then you have to choose, and democratic institutions are the best. But when the nudist wants to appear on a private stretch of beach and the clothed person wants to appear on his beach and there's no clash, there's no occasion to resolve a moral issue.
But isn't really the problem with Deep Throat that it wasn't really shown in discrete locations or discreetly marked theaters as you said it should have been?
Well, I'm in favor of all kinds of regulations. I'm in favor of zoning regulations to keep these kinds of movies out of neighborhoods. I'm in favor of marquee regulations. I'm in favor of age regulations. I'm in favor of mailing regulations. I'm in favor of advertising regulations. My only brief is for having a discreet location where somebody who wants to see something filthy can go and see it, so long as it doesn't offend others who regard that as filthy.
Mr. Buckley, your definition?
Well, I don't roll my own about definitions. The the word obscene is defined, and there is no law save usage, really, as the manipulation of any material, usually sexual material, with the view to stressing lubricity. And it seems to me that any of the stuff that we've discussed is very, very clearly obscene. Now, some obscenities are more offensive than others. Fanny Hill is certainly obscene, but it's almost a lark. It's sort of it's almost a spring wine, by contrast with this other artless junk, to use Professor Dershowitz's word. So I think that people who make up their own definitions for obscenity are simply exercising an authority that nobody conferred on them, and nobody can confer on them.
But Bill, we're reflecting.
Nobody would dream of conferring on Fowler the right to define a word, nor would he accept that responsibility. So there's got to be some sort of a democratic sanction with his usage.
But we're reflecting our own real elitism. You and I prefer Fanny Hill. I have the same feeling. I enjoyed it. It was a lark. It's literate. It's intelligent. But how can we impose that kind of view on the vast majority of people who perhaps would have no appreciation? I would say if you did a popular vote on what people regarded as more of a lark, Fanny Hill, which is incomprehensible unless you've had a college education,
or Deep Throat,
which is appreciable by a different element of society, I think we would find we're in the minority.
Well, I think it's unfortunate that you picked a movie to compare against a book. Pick a book to compare a book against a book. As a matter of fact, it is true. One of my complaints about pornography is that bad pornography tends to drive out good pornography.
Right.
It's rather hard to find good pornography.
You know, I have an experience with that. When I represented earlier on one of the fairly
Yellow.
Good films, I Am Curious Yellow, it was my view at that point that if we took the position that all pornography can be seen, a position which I firmly believed in, that it would hurt the client in that case because it would drive good films like I Am Curious Yellow out of business. Gresham's law of pornography would operate. And I think that's true, but that's true whenever free speech is practiced.
See, there's the difference. I found I Am Curious Yellow boring, whereas Deep Throat I found amusing. Looking at it objectively, taking the fact out that I was a participant in the movie. Some people might find James Joyce totally boring and something like Deep Throat entertaining. So you have a difference. Again, you're talking about social class and elitism versus the average American.
The fact that you have a difference does not make both points equally valid.
Well, no, but I'm just pointing out the subjectivity of the discussion where we're talking about what is obscene, what is good pornography, what is bad pornography, and which has a right to exist.
One rule in a democratic society, I would think, which is the prominent rule, is if you can accommodate all views, don't vote. That is, if all views can be equally accommodated, if you want to read Fanny Hill and somebody else wants to see Deep Throat and nobody wants to be offended by the externality, so we regulate the externality, if there's no clash of legitimate values, why vote and choose? A democratic institution survives best if we vote and choose only when choice is inevitable. And I think in the area of pornography, choice is not necessary.
Thank you, Mr. Reems. Thank you, Professor Dershowitz. Thank you, members of the panel. Thank you all.
Printed, bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. That's Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content and was funded in part by public television stations.